worship this morning, and thank you again for being here, whether you're here with us in person or whether you're watching over the live stream this morning. We're grateful to have you. Amen. We are thankful that you're here. I do not ever believe it's by coincidence or accident that you happen to be here this morning. I believe God has a perfect plan, and in his perfect plan, he said, there's something I have for that person at Transformation Church this morning. So you pray for me, because I promise you, I cannot do this. Amen. The only way I do anything is by the help of the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. And so this morning, I pray that I can be the vessel that he uses to help you today. And so, you know, we're in the middle of a series here on Sunday mornings called Ekklesia. Now that word may be strange to you because we don't speak Greek here. Amen. We speak English, but that is a Greek word that Jesus uses when he's referring to the church, and is used many times throughout the New Testament in reference to what is called the church. The problem is that we've already learned in this series that there's a great misunderstanding when it comes to that word church. Amen? So many people think it's a building when in truth it's a body. So many people think it's a place when in truth it's a people. And so as we're learning and understanding what God said about the church, I'm not really concerned about what I thought the church was or what my grandfather told me the church was or what the preachers told me the church was. I'm more concerned with what does God say the church is, was, and is supposed to be. Amen? And so as we're learning about this, we've talked about several elements of it, and this is the sixth in this sermon series. And this morning, how many of you has ever had an encounter or something, whether it be on a job or with your parents, or we've all had them, and I'm going to let your mind go to whichever one, but where somebody told you and was trying to explain to you in detail how to do this thing, how to perform a function. But, you know, maybe it was on the job and you're on the new job and they're trying to tell you and explain to you in the meeting that you're having about the job. Well, you know, this is what your daily walk will look like. You'll come into work at 7 o'clock and you're going to put on your tool belt and you're going to go out here and you're going to build mobile homes. Amen. That's kind of vague, and it says, okay, so what part of the mobile home am I building? Well, you're going to build the walls and you're going to set them down on the house on the floor and you're going to screw them in. Okay, well, that's good. I think I can handle that. Amen. And then when you get there, you realize you're not using a screwdriver. You're actually using an air compressor, an air hose, and an air gun. And what it is you've been taught how to do it, but you don't know how to do it until you see it lived out. You know what I'm saying? And how many times have we seen that? What we perceive in our mind as being one thing, when we see it actually played out and lived out, it becomes something totally different. Amen? Because in real life, things happen that the book can't equip you for. Amen? You understand what I'm saying? I mean, when real life comes, things aren't the same as what the book said they would be. And so what you find is when real life happens, and when situations and circumstances come up with the church, I mean, Jesus is going to tell us here in our main text, and I'll go ahead and read it. It'll be on your screen for you. But he says, I say unto you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my ecclesia, my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Now that sounds phenomenal. That sounds like the kind of thing I want to be involved in. It don't sound like there's going to be no troubles. Gates of hell can't prevail. Don't sound like there's going to be any issues. Whatever I say goes. Sounds great. Amen? Sounds like a lot of people think marriage is supposed to be. Amen? One or the other enters into it and says, hey, whatever I say goes. You can't fight against me. This is us. Amen? It's the way it's going to be. It's more of a dictatorship. Amen? But the thing is that we find this morning that I enjoy being able to understand how it's played out, because in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, verses 18 through 20, we find that Jesus is giving what we call the Great Commission. It's not going to be a mystery. You look at me. I'm prettier than a screw. Matthew 28, verse 18 through 20. Amen? And so what we find in Matthew 28, verse 18 through 20, is Jesus giving the last statement of his life here on earth before he ascends to heaven, his just beautiful existence of being God. He's died, he's buried, he's resurrected. Now he's walked for 40 days in a glorified body with the people of God. And now before he ascends to heaven, this is one of the last remarks
remarks he gives to them, and this is what he said. He says to them in a nutshell, listen, all authority, all power in heaven and earth has been given to me. So now I want you to go. He said, you. He said, go you. Amen? Go you. Therefore, and teach all nations and preach to them. Amen? And get them saved and get them baptized. I'm summarizing. It's okay. Get them baptized. And then what he says is, and then I want you to teach them to do exactly what I just taught you to do. That's wonderful. That is phenomenal. We hear people talk about these verses all the time. But what does it look like to be lived out? Because if I just read the book, if I just read the instruction manual, the thing I find so often is, as a father, I've had to put together a lot of things at Christmas for my children and all these things. And so many times, I find that when I'm finished, and I do this on my other job a lot, when I'm finished, I have parts left over. Amen? And sometimes it's because I thought I knew how to put it together without reading the instruction manual. And then other times, I read the instruction manual, and there's still stuff left over. And I'm like, okay, so they sent extra just in case I lost something. Amen? And sometimes that is the case, but not often. Amen? And so then my kids were a little intimidated as they got older and understood, well, Daddy, what's that part over there? I don't know. It's not important. Until they get on the bicycle and realize, yeah, that's kind of important. Amen? And so the thing is this morning, seeing something lived out is a lot different than just reading about it. Because it's easy to give a how-to guide if you want to. And I'm not saying that's what Jesus is doing. He's taught them, his followers, for 3.5 years how to live this thing out. And if we really study his life, we see it. But I believe to see it, if we can, in essence, lived out through a historical account, we would need to go to Acts chapter 2. Because there's no other church that we call the Ecclesia, the call out of Jesus Christ. There's no other group of people in all the Bible outside of Acts chapter 2 that had the more successful group of people and doing works for God and seeing mighty miracles accomplished. In Acts chapter 2, you just see a phenomenal, illustrative, historical view of what God said, this is how you do this. This is how you do Matthew 16. This is how you do Matthew 28. This is what I was talking about right here. And so I want to take us there this morning, and I'm going to just go through it. I'm not going to read verse by verse. Read it on your own time. You can hear me preach this morning, summarize the narrative, and then you can get back into it later and read every little line, okay? But in Acts chapter 1, basically, some of the last things Jesus says is he says, hey, listen, guys, I want you to go, and I want you to find an upper room that I already have over there. See, he's got things prepared for you that you don't even understand. Amen? Even in your waiting season, God has a place prepared for you to wait. Amen? And you look at it like, well, God's not hearing me. God's got me on hold. God isn't paying attention. No, God's got you in his waiting room. He's getting ready to call your name. And what should encourage you is everybody else's name he's calling around you, their wait just got over, and your wait has to get over. If you're in the waiting room, your wait is going to be over eventually. Eventually, your name's going to get called, and you don't have to wait no more. Amen? And that's encouraging. Because I wouldn't go to the doctor and just hang out to hang out. I'm hanging out to get help. Amen? And so the good news is he's got you in his waiting room, but he's calling your name. And so he's got him there. He says, go up into the upper room, and this is what you do. Now they are saved. They are baptized with the Holy Ghost. Biblically, they have that. He looked at them at one point, and he told them, he said, you're saved. He breathed on them, the Bible says. And he said, receive the Holy Ghost. This is way before he ascended. Yeah. So they've got the Holy Ghost. They've got salvation. But what we find is they don't have, that they're missing an element of it. They're missing the empowering of the Holy Ghost. Amen. You can have the presence and don't have the power.
Right.
Amen. And so what we find is he says, go there. I want you to pray for the power, the dunamis in the Greek. It means, it's the word we get in English, dynamite. Amen? Doesn't look like much, but it'll blow up something. Amen? And so what he says is, you to pray, and I want you to pray until you be filled with the power, not the Spirit, but the power of the Holy Spirit. And so they get together, 120 or so in this upper room, and that's what they begin to do. They get on their knees and they pray. Notice they don't perform. Notice they don't go out and try to become popular. They understand Jesus has taught them the secret to being my church is that I need to go away. We heard this morning. It's so awesome how God works. I need to go away. I have to go away. Because if I don't go away, I'm one man. I can be right here with Chad and Mark, but I can't be with you in the back, and you can't hear my conversation. Now, can you join in? Sure, but what about the people down the street and across the road and down in another county? I can't be everywhere at one time. I'm in flesh and bone. So it's very needful for you that I go away. But listen, I'm not just going away. I'm going to send my Spirit to come to you, because my Spirit is not limited by flesh and bone. My Spirit can be everywhere, all the time, with everybody, no matter who you are, no matter where you're at. He's going to be there, because the moment you accept Him, He lives in you. You become the temple of the living God. And so He's with you wherever you go, whatever you do, whoever you encounter, you can do it through Him. Amen? And so what we find is, He says, I've got to go away so that you can have my Spirit, and so that greater works than I have done, you can do. And so we find that Jesus ascends to heaven. Now they're up there praying. And the Bible says that they're praying, and they're praying for one thing. They're not praying for the sick. I'm not saying we shouldn't, but they're not. At this moment, they're not praying for the sick. They're not praying for a building. They're not praying for finances. They're praying for one thing, and it's the filling and the power of the Holy Spirit. In other words, they say, if we're going to be the ecclesia, the mission, that's what this is about, the mission of the church, if we're going to fulfill the mission of the church, one thing is needful, and that one thing is we need the filling and the power of the Holy Spirit of God to be the church that Christ has called us to be. Now, there's a lot of churches, there's a lot of buildings, there's a lot of programs, there's a lot of popularity, there's a lot of performing that happens in what we call the church. And all those things, I'm not saying they're bad, I'm not saying that they should just be ostracized and kicked out, but what I am saying, if they perceive the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit of God, then you have nothing more than just a club. You have nothing more than a place to go be entertained. You have nothing more. You're not getting empowered. You're getting entertained. You can leave saying, man, I tell you what, I really enjoyed the music today. What did they sing about? I don't know, but it was good.
Right.
Amen. You see, we come here to get the information so that we can go out there and make a difference. This is where you come to grow. This is where you come to learn. This is where you come to be educated. This is where you come to be empowered through the Word of God. But then you leave here and you're empowered through the Spirit of God to carry that message out into a lost and dying world, out into the darkness. You're supposed to be salt and give the world some savor and flavor. You're supposed to be a light and give the world some shining and hope. You're supposed to be going out and sharing this good news. Go to all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. How do you do that? I'm not a preacher. You may say. You may not have been called to preach in the pulpit, but you've been called to preach His gospel to a lost and dying world. And the only way you can do that, the only way that is even possible, the only way I can even sputter words out of my mouth this morning with some semblance of eloquency is because of the Holy Spirit. And so this morning, you've got to understand, we talked last week about those gifts, we got to understand that the first thing they're looking for is to be filled by the Spirit of God. And we need that filling. The Bible says that in the last days, there's a lot of things going to happen. Now, you got to understand, the last days happened at the moment Jesus died. That's the beginning of the last days. We need to go back to the moment He came. That's the beginning of the last days. So we're in the last moments of the last days. Amen? Because it's been 2,000 years. Now, God's time is not my time. But I'm just saying, we've been in the last days for a while now. Amen? For for 2,000 years plus, we've been in the last days. And so the thing is that I know everybody's thought we're in the last days. We're in the latter part, or at least the middle part, somewhere. We're past the beginning of the last days. Y'all with me? Amen. I mean, I'm not God, and I don't know the day or the hour, but we're somewhere past the beginning of the last days. So we can vehemently say we're in the last days. Amen. But it says in that time frame that there'll be people of God. There'll be churches that have a form of godliness. They love God. Amen. They know how to dress. They know how to talk. They know how to appear. But they deny the what? The power. The power thereof. Now that isn't a problem in Acts chapter 2. Because they prayed for it. And we're praying for a lot of things, but we're not praying, God, fill us with your power. We're not praying, God, fill our services, fill our classes, fill our music, fill our everything, fill our instruments, fill everything in this place. Hey, God, fill the ground out there. Fill every particle of dirt with your power. That way when somebody drives by, they just feel like a magnet pulling the metal. They feel something attracting them to this place because your power is here. And so we find that with power, I was praying. I said, God, how can I get people to understand what you mean by this power thing? How can I get them to conceive and understand? Because them people were down on their knees and they were praying and they were seeking God and they were asking you to fill them with power and with your presence. And Lord, how can I get people just to conceive this idea of your power? And so as I was praying, hold on for a minute.
I didn't think this through. Lord Jesus. I need the Holy Ghost to help me. I'm tired of things.
Sorry about that. We're back from commercial break. All right, so as they were praying and they were saying, God, fill us with your power. Fill us with your presence. Fill us with your might. Fill us so that we can do what you called us to do. It's kind of like these balloons. These balloons look the same on the outside. These balloons all seem to have, you know, latex on the outside. Two of them white, one of them pink. That's because we're not prejudiced around here. We let any color just come in. If pink comes in, we love them too. Amen. We love everybody because Jesus made them all. And so the thing is, I have to throw the pink one in there because I like pink. Amen. And I'm a man. And so the thing is that we find that they all look the same on the outside. But this is the thing. Can you hold this for me? This is the thing. If I begin to just allow God to be God, something begins to happen. There's something different about two of them than the one. Because two of them are filled with something different than the other one's filled with. And it's all about what's on the inside, not what's about on the outside.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
See, we get so caught up on the outside that we forget the inside.
Oh, right.
We go looking around for people and we look at the outside and we never look at the inside. I'm glad that when God chose David to be king, he wasn't looking at the ugly shepherd boy full of dirt. He was looking at the king that was on the inside. Amen? You see, the thing is that a lot of us are going around looking for people. Some of you is looking for a wife. The Bible says the man that finds a wife finds a good thing. He didn't say the man that finds a woman that wants to be a wife, because if she's got the right stuff on the inside, she's already a wife. You understand what I'm saying? Amen? You're looking for a man. Look for a husband. Don't look for a boy. Look for a man. Look for a husband. Look for a provider. Look for a protector. Because if he's that on the inside, it'll come out on the outside. But the thing is, they all look the same on the outside. And we all look like humans. All the churches look the same on the outside. But when you get to know the people, you begin to realize there's something different on the inside. Now the good news is, and I'm gonna pray to Jesus that this works the way I imagined it in my head. Because I didn't test it out. Didn't do a dry run. Alright. The good news is, so here's a guy. He looks right. He feels right. But he don't have no feeling of the Spirit inside of him. Because these two's filled with healing. Y'all figured that out, right? And this one's filled with a bunch of my hot air. That's the way a lot of Christians are. They're filled with, or a lot of people that claim to be Christians. They're filled with a lot of hot air. But they ain't filled with the right stuff. But you know what I found the good news is? If you get enough of the Holy Spirit around people, it'll begin to lift them up. Amen. The thing that was holding them up. Leave it there. I want you to see it every week till it dies. Amen? And so the thing is that this morning, I want you to understand that just like those balloons are filled with the Spirit of God, imagine that. They're going to go places while the other thing filled with air is going to stay places. So what do you want to do for God? Do you want to go places and make a difference for God? Do you want to let people be able to look up to God when they look at you because you're floating higher than everybody else? Hey, you need to be praying. God, fill me. I can't do what you've given me to do without the power of the Holy Ghost. That balloon can't get up there without the power of the Holy Ghost. It needed the Holy Ghost to lift it up because all it is just a balloon. But the moment it gets attached to something that's got something different in it, it begins to get lifted up. God said, I need you to go out into all the world and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. He said, don't go try again, guys. Go pray, 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 pray. And they prayed and they prayed and they prayed and they prayed until finally, all of a sudden, fire came back. So not only will you find with the true ecclesia, the way to carry out the mission is through the filling of the Holy Spirit, it's by the fire of the Holy Spirit. Because you can't do it. And the good thing is that the Bible says God is a consuming fire. Now they were praying, and all of a sudden the Bible says that the Holy Spirit come in like a mighty rushing wind. Amen? And then all of a sudden, flowing tongues of fire slapped them in the mouth. And now you've got a guy that just a few chapters back was a coward and running from God. He's courageous. And he looks at him and he says, I got something I got to tell those people outside. Now realize this is right around the Passover. There's thousands of Jewish people in town. And here's Peter, the fisherman, no education, no doctrinal background. The only thing he's got that's going for him is he spent time with Jesus. Amen? The only thing he's got that he can put on his resume is I hung out with Jesus for a while and I've been praying and now I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. Let me come tell you what God wants you to know. And so he steps out, I imagine on a porch. This is my imagination, let me have it. And he begins to scream. He doesn't have the microphone. He doesn't have a sound guy. He doesn't have a PR team going out there saying, this is what you say, don't say. He doesn't have all those things. All he has is his voice and the filling of the Spirit of God, and he gives to proclaim a message to these people with fire. The Bible again says God is a consuming fire. How many of you have ever drove by and seen a fire? Or come up, I know David has, he's an ex-fireman. How many of you have ever been involved with just coming upon, or whether it's a car, or whether, how many of you, let me be honest, how many of you have just seen the smoke? Yeah. I believe I'm learning that I've got a little semblance of ADD or something, because I find I get distracted really easy. And so if I'm driving and there's a great cloud of black smoke coming up, I forget I'm on the road. I'm like, hey man, what is that? My wife's like, hey. Oh, I know, I saw it out of this eye. What is that? Something's burning. What are you saying? Something about fire makes people curious. Not in an evil, demented way. But I know people that if they see it, they're going to follow till they get to where the fire is. If they see the smoke, they're going to keep driving and they're going to take curves until they get, because that's a big cloud of smoke. That means something is really on fire. And I'm curious, is somebody's house burning? Is it a plant? Well, what's going on that's burning over there? Did some manufacturing place burn up? I mean, I've got to know. And then what if you hear a big boom? Oh, that even makes you more curious, don't it? If there's noise, loud noise associated with the fire, that becomes more curious. And so watch what you find in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 2, they've been up there in the room, and people saw them go up in the room, and they've been up there for days now, and they come down, and as soon as they come down, there's a loud boom. Amen? There's just a loud boom happening up there, and they come down, and Peter's like, let me tell you something. It's because of you that he died. But he ain't dead. He's risen. And you need to get your life right because he loves you. And this religion is sending you to hell. Get in a relationship. I mean, can you imagine? They're like, who's that guy? drinking then too, but so they tried to just count it off. And isn't that what the world tries to do when you start sharing the love of Jesus? They try to find ways to get it off. But you know what helped them? The filling of the Holy Spirit. Because then they began to speak in different languages of all the 16 nationalities that were there. They began to speak in German. They began to speak in French. Now this is a fisherman. He don't know how to do this stuff. And he begins to speak in Hispanic languages. And he begins to speak in Oriental languages. And they're like, wait a minute. Did I just hear him call something in my language? Did he just tell me Jesus loves me in Spanish? Did he just tell me that Jesus loves me in French? Did he just tell me Jesus loves me in Russian? What in the world is going on? Did he tell me Jesus died for me in my language? I mean, God got it so tuned in that he come on my radio frequency in my language and began to speak to me. How did he do that? And Peter's up there, thank God for the Holy Ghost. Fire. And all of a sudden, people become attracted to fire. And so now you've got a group of people out there and there's thousands getting saved. He didn't get with everybody beforehand up in the upper room and say, hey, I don't know how this is going to happen. We're going to need all the workers. No, they just used their gifts in the Spirit. And I believe there was people saying, hey, I know how to pray. Come here. Let me tell you what Jesus wants you to know. And they just began using their gifts together like we talked about last week. And they began to see God do a great work through, hey, they didn't even have a name. Did you know that? This isn't the First Baptist Church of Acts 2. The only name they had was where the ecclesia, where God's called out people, and we're meeting in the power of the Holy Spirit, filled with Him, and we come to take you to a place you can't go by yourself. So let us lift you up. Let us help carry you there. Let us get you to where you need to be. So we see the filling, we see the fire. So what happens? What happens when they left? I get it. So they had a church service, preacher. Well, if you want to call it that. They had their Sunday morning church service. People, 3,000, 4,000 people get saved. Wonderful. Amen. It's exciting. They're talking about it all week, ain't they, preacher? I know they're calling everybody up and they're saying, man, did you see what Peter did on Sunday? Man, Peter blew it out of the park. Peter did this. Peter did that. Man, I can't believe what Peter did. Now, I don't believe Peter even got brought up. They said, did you see what Jesus did on Sunday morning? Can you imagine that Jesus used Peter that way? Can you imagine that Jesus, I mean, what? Jesus just gave Peter some kind of power there through the Holy Spirit. And he went out there in Jesus' name. And because he used Jesus' name, all men was drawn to him because he lifted him up. And we saw something we didn't even think was possible. I mean, we were just a little ragtag group of people. Everybody else was run away because of the fear of the Roman government. And now we're thousands in number. And all of a sudden, in one day, we've got thousands on our side. I mean, can you imagine what's going to take place now? Now what do we do? So Peter and some of the other disciples looked and they said, hey, meet me in my house tomorrow night. Now I know some of you just lost. I lost a lot of you. He said, preacher, we're not coming to your house tomorrow night. Good. I really didn't want you to. Amen? But this is my point. I want you to notice that not only were they filled, not only were they on fire, but they were fed. Now, understand something. The Bible says they met in each other's houses every day. But notice what it says. They broke bread together, but they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrines and teaching. Amen? So what it's telling me is they didn't meet just to have a social gathering. When they met together for the purpose of being educated on how to live out this life called Christianity. Now, the social gathering is important, and we'll get to that in a second. And the community is important, and we'll get to that in a second. But right now, I want you to understand, they understood the concepts of the only way we can carry out the mission of Jesus' ecclesia is, number one, I've got to be filled with the Spirit. That's only going to come, the filling of the power. Now, you can have the Spirit, and I'll be filled with the Spirit. Do you understand? Because all the things in this world, it's like it drains you, if you will. Amen? Like a gas tank on your car. You just can't keep driving off one tank forever. You eventually got to go get refilled. Amen? And so they were filled with the power of the Spirit. They had to continually pray, God, fill me with your power. Amen? And then what we find is, not only that, we find they had the power of the Spirit. Because God is a consuming fire. And so if there's the filling, there's going to be fire. And the fire draws curiosity. People want to know what's going on over at that group of people meeting at Transformation Church. What is going on there? I hear things and God's moving and people's getting healed and all the stuff. And people's getting delivered and people's getting saved. And they've got, I mean, they've got all kinds of people there from all cultures and all different, you know, diversity. And they like different things. And what's going on there?
Curiosity, the fire begins to draw. It becomes about Jesus instead of about us. Amen. And that fire begins to draw people, and they want to come and hear what's going on, and they want to hear what's going on in your life because they realize you've got a new fire about you. You're excited now. And it shows. Amen. It shows. That's what happened to Moses. He just got a case of Holy Ghost heartburn so bad that his face glowed. Amen. He became a glowworm. Those were popular when I was a kid. You squeezed them and their face lit up and you could sleep with them and not be scared at night. I'm glad Jesus is like a, Moses was just like a glowworm. God squeezed him and he lit up. Amen? And he said, I don't have to be afraid. I'm good. So the thing is that we find here that they were fed. And it's important for us to realize that in order to do church Jesus, if we're going to be a part of his church, he doesn't want us out there being careless with the information that he's given us. Let me ask you this. The Bible compares God's word to a sword, a two-edged sword, which means that it's going to cut no matter which way it's swung. Now, one-edged sword's bad enough. If you got a one-edged sword, that means it can cut me if he's swinging to his left. Amen? But if he hits me to his right, it might hurt, might leave a welt, but it's not going to kill me. Amen? Not a big deal. But a two-edged sword, that's dangerous. And so how many of us would allow a five-year-old kid to use our two-edged ninja sword or our marine sword, amen, that's two-edged, we'd say, okay, hey, little buddy, little Johnny, come up here, we're going to let you hold the sword and we're all going to walk by and just let you take a whack at us. He's unskilled. Why would you do that? And what we're learning here is they needed to learn and be skilled in the Word of God so that they could take that Word out into life and properly, skillfully handle themselves and the Word of God. Because so much damage has been done to what we call the church today because of unskilled people mishandling the Word of God and giving out wrong information instead of right information. And so it's very important. The Bible said this in Hosea 4 and 6, that my people are destroyed due to lack of knowledge. In other words, they don't know how to handle the Word. Amen? And because they don't have, they're ignorant. I don't mean you're stupid. I mean you're ignorant. You're unlearned. They don't understand, and they're ignorant based on the Word of God. And so when they leave the house of God, some of them leave more ignorant than when they came in. But I'm here to tell you, I pray to God that he will help me to help you leave with more wisdom and more education and more truth. Because the truth will set you free. More truth that when you leave here, you can share that truth with the world and they can be fed from your hand. But we find that that's what they were doing. They were coming and they were getting fed. So in order to carry out the mission of the church, they needed the filling, they needed the fire, they needed the feeding. But last but surely not least, in Acts chapter 2, we find they needed a family. Now this is important. Because this is where the rubber meets the road. Because I have so many people telling me things like, well, you know, I don't understand this local church thing. Well, you must understand it if you're going to be educated, because Jesus ordained it. He established it. He started it, if you will, when he walked to Peter and said, hey, follow me, stay with me, and then I'm going to get these people to stay with you. As a matter of fact, this is what Paul said. Paul said, follow me. What do you mean to follow you? You're a human. Used to be a murderer. Why am I going to follow you? Because I know who I'm following. Right. And so if you follow me, instead of following them, I know where you're going to end up. Amen? He talked to the local church of Corinth. He talked to the local church of Ephesus. He talked to the local church of Philippi. He talked to all these local churches. What was the deal about the local church? He said, you need, remember we talked about the body last week? You are part of a body. So imagine that, let's just say here in our congregation, let's say there's something God is wanting to do among us, but he hasn't gifted anybody here yet to do that inside. Now, could he? Absolutely. But he says, you know what? I've got a person out there.
Let's just use a real example. Right now, we don't have anybody that plays the piano right now. Okay? So I'm going to use it for an example. Let's say that I don't believe God gave us this piano just to sit here and for us to dust it every week to make it look pretty for just pretty sake. Amen? I believe it's over there for a purpose. Amen? And so let's say this. Let's say that somebody in here, maybe they've been taught the talent how to play, but they don't have the passion to play. I mean, they don't enjoy it. We've seen Jacob Klutz come here. Now, he enjoys playing the piano. Amen? He's up here rocking. And, I mean, he looks like Jerry Lee Lewis on the piano for Christ. Amen? I was waiting one day for him to slide his rear end across the keys and say, praise God. Amen? But the thing is that he's just happy. He loves doing what he does because he knows that he only can do that because of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so he's excited about it. He didn't learn it just to learn it or just to play because mom and daddy said to. He knows how to play because that's what he's gifted and talented to do. God said, I want you to play, he plays. Amen? So we get back to our scenario. We don't have anybody that does it. But let's imagine that there's somebody that's playing in the bar every Saturday night. And they're drinking while they play. And they're getting drunk and they're playing. You know, they're playing, their dog left them and their girlfriend left them and all that good left them. It must be country music, amen? So they're playing that. So all of a sudden, they come in contact with a couple of people filled with the Holy Ghost. And they start seeing things from a new level than they saw before. And then all of a sudden, they're filled with the Holy Ghost. And then people say, hey, why don't you come to church with me on Sunday to the place where we worship? You know, the church is us people. Just come down to the place where we meet at. And they go with them. And then they hear word that, oh man, y'all need a piano player? Just so happens I love playing the piano. You see what God's doing? But let's break it down to the family and get back off the gifts, because the thing I realize is we need family. I told you last week that God told Eve and Adam, he said, everything I've made is good, but there's one thing that I see that's not good, and that's that man should not be alone. Mankind, not man, mankind. In other words, you need each other. Everybody needs somebody to lean on. Everybody, the Bible says, it's no good for one man to walk by himself, because if he falls in a ditch, who's going to help him out? It's better that two walk together. The Bible says that two by two I'll send you out. You see, it's good to have family. It's good to have people. We need friends. We need camaraderie. We need companionship. Amen? And just to give you a firm example of what I'm talking about, there's people that I've had in my church families before, in my group of people that I'm assembled with. We've got some like that right now. They don't have any family. They don't have anybody. I mean, they don't have a brother that talks to them. They don't have a mother that talks to them. Their children may not have nothing to do with them. And they're living good lives. They're trying to love Jesus. But the only family they have is this. See, the problem is a lot of us have a lot of family. And so we don't look at this as our family. But God wants you to understand, if you're part of the ecclesia, you're part of a family. That's why I use that word all the time. You're part of a family. How do we know they were part of a family? The Bible says they cared for each other. The Bible says they sold their big screen TVs. That's what it said. 72 inches, came off the wall, went to the pawn shop in Bethlehem, and they said, here, you don't have food. That's more important than me watching America's Got Talent tomorrow night. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. Amen? In so many words. I want you to understand, they care for each other. They loved each other. They took care of each other. When one of them hurt, they all hurt. They said, we can't let this person go through this by themselves. What can we do as a family to help? When one of them rejoiced, they all rejoiced. I mean, really. When one of them got a job promotion, they all got excited. Amen? When one of them had to come out and said, I'm pregnant, they all just got all excited like it was their baby. Amen? When one of them said, I'm getting married, they all got excited. I mean, everybody rejoiced together. Everybody hurt together. Everybody met together. They loved each other's company. They didn't all have the same interests. One of them liked soccer. One of them liked basketball. They didn't all like the same things. One of them's favorite color was pink. The other was gray. And they all liked different things. But the problem is that they had one commonality that drew them together, and his name was Jesus. Amen? Then they said, hey, we've come together. We've been brought into this family, adopted as sons and daughters by one. same Father is the same God of us all. The same Savior is the same Savior of us all. The same Spirit is the same Spirit in us all. So if we're going to carry out the mission of Jesus' Ecclesia, we need to be a family. Because if not, the Bible says, what separates us from the world? Who won't do good to somebody that does good to them? But when you do good to somebody that does you wrong, that's how you find the difference. And so when you find a group of people that really love each other, really stick together and say, we're going to go through this. I know you messed up, but guess what? We love you. And we're going to help you through it because we're filled with the Holy Spirit. We can lift you up. We can help you. You don't have to die and just dwindle away. We can help you get back on your feet. This morning, I wonder if we were to examine ourselves, because you're the church. I'm the church. If I'm to examine my own life, do I say that, hey, once you're signed that I'm the church, I can carry out the mission of being the church as I'm filled with the Spirit of God? I may look like everybody else as far as a human being, but on the inside, there's something different inside of me than some of those people I'm around. I'm filled with the Spirit. Number two, have you lost your fire? Get it back. Think about this. Once the fire is gone, everybody goes home. Amen. Once the smoke is cleared, nobody's paying attention no more. Do you not think the devil has a whole fire department in hell putting out fires that God has started? I promise you he does. He's got them all over this earth, and he's saying, hey, go put out that fire. Go put out that fire. Find a way to put it out in Jody's life. Don't let him stay excited for me, because if he stays excited for me, he's going to burn this whole place and mess it up. Get, make sure. That's why we have to say, God, fill me with your Spirit and fill me with your fire. Then we have to get fed. That's why it's so important to be in a place that's teaching the truth of God's Word, so we can get fed. And then lastly, we need to be a part of the family. We need to care about each other, not just on Sunday morning when it's convenient. You see each other and say, hey, oh, you're sick, I'm praying for you, and then forget about them. What happened to Monday? You say, well, I'm not going to go to their house. Well, that's fine. Why don't you call them up? Why don't you send them a text? So easy in our day and time. Just say, hey, I'm praying for you. I love you. I'm not bragging, but on my way here, this morning I was talking to texting in my phone. I sent about 7 messages to fellow pastors that I love and care about that are my family in Christ. I said, hey, I'm praying for you this morning. I hope everything goes well at your church. I'll say that to brag. I'm just saying that because I think that makes a difference. Because I've got those texts from my pastor, and I'm like, man, I knew that was coming. Amen? So what happens when we got somebody in a hospital or somebody hurting, somebody going through a relationship issue, and we just say, hey, I love you, I'm praying for you. Is there anything I can do? Find out somebody had surgery. Can we bring you some food? Find out somebody's in the hospital. Can we come visit and just encourage you a little bit? Find out, I mean, family. That's what we do, right? As family, let's do it. Because that's the only way we're going to carry out the true mission of Jesus, and to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and then teach them to do what we're doing. That's why the church is dying, because we've been teaching them to do what we're doing, and we're doing nothing. Because when you get that fire, you'll want to go do something for Jesus. Amen. I promise you, if I set you on fire right now, you wouldn't sit still. I promise you. So we need to pray, God, set us on fire. Fill us with your Spirit. Feed us from your Word, and help us to find a family we can be a part of that loves you. This morning, as they play something from the sound booth, I ask if you will to stand to your feet, heads bowed and eyes closed this morning. You know, this morning, I'm so thankful that I know without a doubt that I have God's presence in my life. That's the most comforting thing out of everything I could ever speak to you that I'm comforted with, that I know that. But you know what else makes me excited this morning is that I don't just have to settle for just his presence. Notice he says in Matthew 28, 18, all power
is given to me in heaven and earth. And then he says, go pray for that power. The same power that raised me from the dead is the same power that I want to fill you.
Yeah.
And it's the same power that I want to work for you as you go out and use your gifts that I've blessed you with. I don't want you to go out and do it off skill. I don't want you to go out and do it off of educated learning out of a book. I want you to do it because you can only live it out through my power. Effectively. And the only way you're going to know how to live it out is to come and be fed. When you get fed, then you can go practice what you've learned in principle. And then lastly, I want you to be a group of people that loves each other, that even calls each other family. You look at each other, you can use the words brother and sister and mean it from your heart. When you look at each other, you can say, I love you, and really mean those words. This morning, I don't know about you, and I can't speak for everybody, but I want to carry out the mission of the church Jesus come to build, because that mission may seem like mission impossible, but the truth of the matter is all things are possible through Christ. And the truth of the matter is, that's the church that no weapon can form against that can conquer. And when I say church, I'm talking about you. And that's the group of people that even though you may go through a hard time, thank God for the ones filled with the Spirit that will lift you up and God bring by your side. Thank God for the Holy Spirit that will encourage you. Thank God for the power of the Spirit of God that you can rebuke that devil and get him away from you. And you're an overcomer. You're more than a conqueror. And so this morning, maybe you're here and your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed and you say, Pastor, you know what? I don't even know if I've got the presence of God in my life. I've never surrendered my heart and soul to Him as Lord and King of my life. I've never surrendered. I've never repented of my sins and said, I'm sorry. And I'm a good person, I think. I think I do pretty good, but I know I don't have His presence living in me. And preacher, I believe in heaven. I believe in hell. I believe in God. I believe in the devil. I know without a doubt I'm a sinner and I do wrong. And I need something to deliver me from that. But I don't know that I would spend eternity with Jesus in His eternal kingdom. I want you to pray for me. Nobody's looking. Me and God. Would you slip your hand up really quick and say, preacher, pray for me. I know that's me. I'm not truly 100% sure that I've ever received Christ and I'm saved. Would you pray for me? Anybody at all, real quick. Maybe you hear me say, preacher, I know I'm saved. I know His presence dwells in me. But I know I've not been walking, living, and functioning in His power. I want you to pray for me as I lift my hand, and you'll just pray that I can be filled with His power. The power of the Holy Ghost, and I can do what He's called me to do. Anybody raise that hand? Thank you. I see that. Anybody else? Thank you. Anybody else raise that hand real quick? Just pray for me, preacher, that I can do what God's called me to do through His power. I see that hand. Anyone else before we pray? I see that hand. Thank you. I thank you. I see that hand. Anybody else? This morning, maybe you're here and you say, preacher, I just want to learn more about God, I want to grow in God, I want to be a part of the family. I don't know how God spoke to you, but while the music plays this morning, and continues to play from the sound booth, I ask you, if you need to come this morning, why don't you come? Why don't you step out and say, God, fill me with your power. That's the way they got it. They had to pray for it. I wish I could pray for it for you. And I do, truthfully. All the time I pray, God, fill our people with your power and your presence. And this morning, I want you to come, though. I want you to come personally, and I want you to say, God, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. And it's not that I'm a bad person, and it's not that I'm doing evil things necessarily. It's just that I want your power in my life. I want people to see you in my life. I want them to know that I'm filled with the presence of a holy God. I want to be able to encourage and lift people up. I don't want to drag them down. I don't want to be full of hot air. God, I want to be filled with your presence. God, feed me from your word. God, show me where I need to be in relation to the family and how I need to be acting and the things I need to be doing. Help me to be a good family member. God, even to the black sheep of the family, if you will. God, to the ones that don't want nobody, let me love them. Let me care for them. This morning, if you're here, you have a situation, you have a circumstance, maybe you have a need in your life this morning. I know the person who's your answer for your needs. Whether it be a job, whether it be finances, whether it be family problems, if it's a faith issue, if it's devils fighting you, if it's temptation and trials and trouble, if you're sick, I know a healer. He's just waiting on you to come. He says, you have not because you ask not. And this morning, God has your answer.
answer him. All power. Did you hear what he said? All power is given to me in heaven and in earth, things of the earth. And so there's nothing he can't do. He's just waiting on you to ask him. He's waiting on you to come to him and say, Lord, this is what I need from you. And when you say it and you mean it, and it lines up with his word, he'll begin to move. He'll begin to minister to you. He'll begin to manifest his presence in your life. Father, this morning we bow our hearts and minds to you in realizing that you have all power in heaven and in earth. We want to thank you for the presence of the person of the Holy Spirit. He's not just a force, he's not just an energy, he's a person. And I thank you that he lives in us, God. I thank you that his presence is real. I thank you that his power is felt. And I thank you that it's evident in our lives. And God, it's the thing that brought us out of darkness into your light. And God, this morning, I pray that the Holy Spirit would continue to teach us and educate us and empower us and enable us to carry out your mission on this earth. God, may we be able to go into every corner of this world, into every workplace, into every school system. May we be able to go into every family gathering. May we be able to go in everywhere we go, every convenience store, every grocery store, every vacation spot, and God, may people see the love of Jesus Christ through us. God, I pray this morning that we can reach a lost and dying world with the hope that Jesus loves them. And God, this morning I pray that as this group of people that we call transformation, that we truly transform lives, not only in Rowan County, but in every county surrounding it, and then across the United States of America, and then into every corner of the world. God, may we just be able to make a difference for your kingdom's sake. God, we love you this morning, and we thank you for the truth of your word. May we be able to be that Acts chapter 2 church. May we be able to take their model and take that living it out historical account, and may we live it out in the same capacity, with the same compassion. God, we love you this morning, and help us to be what you call us out to be. In Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated this morning. As our ushers come forward, I want to ask you to give this morning as the Lord has given to you so that we can go and we can be the hands and feet of Jesus in the financial areas that we need to, and so that we can keep things going the way we need to keep them going. I wish to God that the power company would understand when I call them up and say, hey, Jesus, I love him and he's my king. And they would say, no problem, you just have free power. I wish it was that way, but we live in a world that doesn't understand that he owns the power. So they try to charge me for the power he owns, and I have to pay that bill. And so understand that it costs money to function. Amen? That's the point I'm trying to make. It costs money to function. And so your money helps us do that. And not only that, we want to get to the point where we can not only just survive, but we can thrive for the kingdom. Amen? So give back to God as he's given to you this morning. Is my prayer. Let's pray. Father, bless the offering. Bless every gift. Bless every giver. God, I thank you for every dollar that you've put in the pockets of your people this week. And I pray that we can learn to trust you more and more and more with every penny, every nickel, every quarter, and every $1 million you put in our pocket. Whatever it is, I pray we can learn to trust you with it and just trust you to just be obedient and more. Pour out your blessings on your people in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Two announcements I didn't mention earlier. One is praise team practices today at 5 o'clock. So if you're on the praise team, or maybe you're interested in being a part of the praise team, amen, just see Jennifer, and she can tell you about that. We'd love to have you come be a part of our praise team. And we're actually working on a band and some instruments being played. So you do any of that, you're interested, God might have spoke to you and said, hey, your dad played in the bar last night drinking a beer. I want you to play piano this week. Amen. Hey, I love you. I want you to play piano. Amen. And so the thing is that if God spoke to you, then be sure and see Jennifer. Then also, if any of the ladies that are here, we're taking a trip as a church family of ladies, okay, next year in May, and Women of Joy is going to be at Myrtle Beach, South Carolina.
So they're going to be going there. And Christina has all the information on the sheet that's been typed up. So if you're interested in that, see her, because we need to have a meeting on that probably in the next few weeks so that we can start making reservations and I can get actual pricing. So see her today. I think she's going to write down names today of those that are interested. And that way we have a number so we know how lodging and all that good stuff that's included in that. So please see her today. Amen. Before you leave and say, hey, I want to go, put my name down. And if you're giving money to that, be sure to fill it out on your envelope, on your tithing envelope. Be sure to put on there Women of Joy, because if not, it goes into tithes. So just label that envelope Women of Joy, and that way we know that money's going there. Or you can hand it directly to Christine. Amen. Yes, it is so great to have you today. And we thank God for each of you, and I appreciate you sharing your life. I have a hospitality room right through these doors, and I would love to take 5 minutes with you and just pray with you and say hello, put a name and a face together with your guest card, and that way we can just spend a few minutes together. But more than anything, I just want to pray with you this morning. Amen. But before we leave, real quick, Devin and Jamie, y'all want to come up? Amen. I am so thankful to have these guys be coming here and being our guests for a while now. And I appreciate them so much and their love and just getting to know them. And in discussing and talking with them, they want to become covenant partners with Transformation Church. Amen. So they're both very safe. There's some baptism that needs to happen, and we'll get that taken care of. So they're coming as candidates for baptism and on their statement of faith, and they want to be a part of our group of family. Amen. And I want to say this morning, if there's anybody else here that would like to do that, the doors are open at this moment, and they're always open, but the doors are open if you want to do that. We'd love to have you be a part of our family here, and we'd love to have you come with us. There is a criteria that we like to meet, and that's that growth track. So if you've not taken growth track, you can go ahead and say, hey, as soon as I get growth track done, I want to be a part of the covenant family. We can do that ahead of time or after the time, but we'd love to have you, if the Lord leads, to be a part of our family here. Amen? And so what I want you to do as you're leaving this morning is I want you to come by and shake their hand and tell them you're glad to have them. Amen? And I think they already feel like they're part of the family. Amen, already. So I'm thankful for that. Amen. That even before they made it official, we adopted them in and said, we don't care. Amen. We're going to make you part of the family anyway. Amen. And so we appreciate them so much. And so make sure they know that this morning. Amen. Are you glad you came this morning? Did the Lord bless you? If you did, give them a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. All right, let's close in prayer. We're going to go. Again, if you're here this morning as a first-time guest, I'd love to meet you for just a few minutes in the hospitality room. Amen? So I'm going to let Mark close us in prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father God, we